want me to add more, and you can't wait to pour it out on me.
Come on.
So as I was having a conversation with Jesus one day, I was kind of stomping my feet at him. I was like, come on, Jesus, where's my more? And he says, you've done well ministering to my children. Now minister to me. You minister to me as well as you minister to my children, you'll have the more. So I've been on this adventure of discovering what that means. Because it does minister to God's heart when I minister to his kids, but there's something that happens when all my attention, all my devotion, all my adoration is focused solely on him. Telling him who he is, how good he is, how faithful he is. God's had this running theme with me over the past week about worship. And it's more than just declaring about him. It's more than just singing about his faithfulness. It's declaring his faithfulness. It's declaring his goodness. It's declaring to him who he is to us. And there's a precious lady that had a vision of, as we are, of her and the Lord, and as she was just declaring about how good he is. Lord, you're so good, you're so faithful, you're so amazing, you're so beautiful, you're so trustworthy. She said what she saw was he was holding like this big mirror, and it was reflecting back onto her.
Amen.
So the Lord was showing me this is the next way of strengthening myself in the Lord, is declaring who he is, because he's speaking right back onto us.
Yeah.
And that is such a beautiful form of worship that becomes that lifestyle of being plugged into that lifeline, because it becomes a lifeline. We have to be reminding who he is. We have to remind ourselves who he is, his goodness and his faithfulness. I mean, we have to be reminded that he sees us the same way.
Is the place of affection that I have in the heart of God is what empowers me to celebrate. What does that mean? It means worship is not something that we do for God. It's something that he initiates in us. It's like he gives us this vision of himself. And when you look at him, you start celebrating who he is. So I love the fact that God is passionate towards me. I love the fact that he loves promises, that he loves the favor that he lavishes on our lives. And so worship is drawn from that place of belonging in God's affection, of being seated in God's affection and rooted in God's affection. So that worship explodes from within you. So that when you are engaged with him, you're engaged with his love for you, because we love him because he first loved us. So we're engaged with his passion for us, his favor in us. The fact that he is so delighted to put us into Jesus. And so as we come to worship, we're worshiping in a safe place, and from a safe place of victory, power, blessing, promise, favor. And so as I was standing there in the presence of God, surrounded by the presence of God, and worship then is drawn up out of us. And so in that context then, worship is a lifestyle. Yeah. It's not something you just do in meetings.
Right.
That's why thanksgiving and rejoicing are mentioned so much, because it's God always reminding us, remember it's the lifestyle. Remember to give thanks. Remember to rejoice in all things, because it makes you attached to God in worship. In all of our situations, we should give thanks before we pray. Otherwise, we'll pray in fear. But if you give thanks beforehand, you become attached to who God is in the place of worship, and then your mind can go to a different place, and you can hear something different that causes you to pray differently. So worship calls us into that place of acceptance. God sets this stage in our life that says, you can access anything I have in this place of worship. So learn to stay in this place of worship all through the day. And that's just simply by every so often just coming to that place of giving yourself to worship for a few minutes. It means being God conscious. It means allowing your heart and mind to get drawn into that place where you are embracing the affection and the permission and the favor and the blessing that God has for you. And you are surrounded by His passion for you. I love the fact that whatever God wants from us, He always tends to initiate in us. He gives it to us first. If He wants love from us, He will give love to us. If He wants us to rejoice, He will let us taste His joy. If He wants us to be free from anxiety, He will give us peace. And so in that place of constantly rejoicing and giving thanks, what we're doing is we're keeping ourselves in the love of God, keeping ourselves in the frame where God is, keeping ourselves in the same space that He occupies. That inner man of the Spirit is drawn to worship. So worship comes from the inside to the outside. It's a lifestyle. We never exit worship. We never leave it. We're always in it because we're citizens of heaven, learning how to do on earth what everyone does naturally around the throne. We're always welcome before the throne of God. We always stand in the place of grace with God. There's always something to give thanks for, always something to rejoice for. There's always a place of worship in every single situation. And the beauty of all of that, He initiates it in us. It's not something we do for Him. It's something that He surrounds us with His presence, and worship is drawn up as a result. So look for the presence of God today. Look for the presence of God and allow that worship that's already in you to come out. We never exit worship because we're always in the presence of God.
Amen.
He said this part about staying in the love, staying in that, in the presence. And that's a place we need to choose to be into. And there was a season where Jeremy and I leading worship a lot in different places. It was as we're going to this location or as we're driving to this place, there'd be a time of okay, now we're just gonna like get ourselves ready to worship. And yes, there's this place of preparing our hearts to be able to lead others to the throne room. But the reality is that's something we should never have to prepare for. We should already be there all the time. And being in that place grows this really cool thing in us. It's trust. And when we can trust unabandoned, well, the word God gave me a few months back was ruthless trust. When we can live in this place of absolute ruthless trust, that can only come from abiding all the time. That can only come from planting ourselves and letting our roots grow down deep where they're supposed to, where in His presence. Because sometimes God asks us to do some really seemingly bizarre things, and unless we're so used to His presence and so used to His voice and planted so firmly with Him, that trust can be a really hard thing. But staying in that place of worship produces trust.
Grace is your power. It's God's power. Thank you.
The Lord bless you and keep you. let us walk in that today. Let us walk in the shining of your face. Let us constantly be recognizing where your affection, where your gaze is turned, so that we can imitate you, keeping our affections and our gaze fixed on you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Bishop. Thank you so much. Delight, delight, delight. Thank you, Polly.
Yes. Thank you, Hannah.
She can have a copy. She can see your finger movements.
Oh.
That's what I...
Oh, that is so nice of you.
Well.
Yeah. I'm doing vibrato. That comes later. Wait, what key are we playing in? See? Or G?
Thank you.
Wait, there's only really one verse, right? Yeah. Okay.
I'm going to sing.